FET biasing and current sources. As far as FET biasing is concerned, if we consider an n-channel device, the circuit is the same whether it is a JFET or a MOSFET. Even if it is a MOSFET, it could be either depletion type or enhancement type. The circuit is the same. So if we consider an FET as having three terminals, gate, drain and source, the symbol is different for different types of FET, but we are considering an n-channel, then we have to have a resistance R sub D, and this goes to a source of voltage VDD. Note the change of symbols. The drain instead of the collector, so RD and VDD, and the current through RD is I sub D. And then the gate biasing is done in exactly the same manner as we do the base biasing in a JIF, in a BJT. That is, we use two resistances, R1 and R2. And at the source, we use another resistance, exactly like the emitter resistance. And to distinguish this from the source resistance, signal source resistance, okay, you know the signal source would be here, and this usually we call RS, and this is the signal source VS. In order to distinguish between RS, the source internal resistance, and the resistance connected to the source terminal of the FET, we denote this by R sigma. All right, you understand the meaning of this subscript sigma. This is just to distinguish between this resistance and this resistance. Of course, the output is taken from the collector, not collector, the drain, and there is a resistance RL across which the signal output is taken. Okay. Now, unlike, all right, let me recall the symbols. If it is a JFET, then the symbol would have been simply this, n-channel JFET. If it is an MOS FET of the depletion type, pardon me? Of the depletion type, two lines, and you have a drain. This is the connection. On the other hand, this is the depletion type MOS FET, D-MOSFET. I'll bring this here, D-MOSFET. On the other hand, if this is an enhancement type, then you have three lines like this. This is the drain, this is the source, and this is the gate. Okay. In either of these three, in any of these three devices, the same circuit shall be effective. Now, you notice that the difference between BJT and FET is that the gate is virtually insulated. If it is MOS, it is DC insulated, absolutely. Metal oxide semiconductor, so it's a capacitor, basically. So the gate does not take any current. Gate does not take any current. All that
in MOSFET.
In JFET, the gate and source is a reverse biased junction. The gate and source is a reverse biased junction, and therefore that also takes negligible current. In other words, the gate current I sub G can be taken to be zero. The gate current I sub G can be taken to be zero. So the FET basically, and you know the gate controls the current I sub D. The gate to source voltage controls the current I sub D. So FET basically is a voltage controlled device. All right. You also notice that as far as DC is concerned, the voltage at the gate is simply VGG equal to VDD R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Agreed? So this is the equivalent of VBB. Agreed? Equivalent of VBB in a BJT. All right? And the equivalent of the resistance RB would be the parallel combination of R1 and R2. All right? But it does not go, as in a BJT, it does not go to a diode. It goes to an open circuit. All right? And I sub D is the I sub D is the drain current. Let us look at the DC equivalent circuit of this. We have a battery VGG, then we have the resistance R sub G, which we have already defined. This is the gate terminal, and this remains open. All right. At the at the other terminal, we have, what do we have? A VDD, okay, in series with a resistance of R sub D and a what? Where does R sub D go? Isn't there a current source? There is a current source which is I sub D. We are considering the DC equivalent circuit. There is a current source I sub D. Then this goes to, what is this terminal now? Drain. No. The drain terminal is here.
Source.
This is the source terminal. And therefore from here we have the current R, the resistance R sigma to the ground. Okay, this is the equivalent circuit.
Can you show
so
the drain terminal also
in
this?
Tell me, what is the, which is the drain terminal?
Just before the current source.
Just before the current source. That is correct. This is the drain terminal.
Won't there be a resistance of the N-channel which we
have? Resistance of the N-channel. Well, we'll come to this later, yes. There is a resistance, yes. We'll come to this later. This is that RD, which you shall consider for dynamic resistance. Small r subscript small d, that is DID, I'm sorry, DVDS DID. What he is talking of is this, the dynamic resistance. This we shall consider in the AC equivalent circuit. As far as DC is concerned, we don't have to. Okay, now you notice that here the controlling voltage is VGS, that is this voltage. This is the controlling voltage, and you notice that this is, since the gate current is zero, this is equal to VGG minus the source voltage is I sub D R sigma. Is that clear? This is the golden relationship that we shall have to exploit. Now let's review a little bit about what we learnt about the different kinds of FET. Let's review the relationships, then we shall go to this relation and see how to exploit this. You know that the drain current in an FET is given by, if it is a junction type, is given by IDSS 1 minus VGS divided by VP whole squared, provided VDS is greater than VGS minus VP, where VP is a pinch of voltage. Okay, for an N-channel JFET, VP is usually a negative quantity. VP typically is, let's say, minus 3 volts, and your VGS, the gate to source voltage, has to be less negative than 3 volts in order for the transistor to conduct. In other words,
is there any equivalent region like saturated cutoff reactance?
Yes, if you remember the characteristics are exactly similar to BJT characteristics, except that there is a slope here. there is a slope here and the characteristics are like this. Okay, and this line is given by VDS is equal to VGS minus VP, this line. Okay, and before that, before this line, the characteristic is like this. It's the oblique region. It's the oblique region. Okay, and this, if this is for VGS equal to 0, all right, then this voltage, this is minus VP. All right, because this line is VDS equal to VGS minus VP. All right, so the flat portion of the characteristic is the saturation characteristic. The current reaches saturation there, and this current for VGS equal to 0 is obviously IDSS, the drain current under saturation condition, and this is I sub T.
Basically,
it's
saturation region.
That's right. That is correct. The FET must be operated in the saturation region. It is there that you can exploit the characteristics for a linear amplification. And as you go down, VGS becomes negative. Let's say minus maybe 1, minus 1.5, this may be minus 2. Well, these are not to scale. And what is this line corresponds to? VGS equal to not minus VP, simply VP. So this is the cutoff line. This is the cutoff line, and these are the saturation characteristics. Okay. Let's make them to scale. Maybe this is minus 3. In this case, VP is approximately minus 4 volt. Okay. You can't go beyond this. On the other hand, if the transistor, if the FET is an MOS type, MOS depletion type, okay, if it is MOS depletion, then the characteristics are written like some constant K multiplied by VGS minus VT squared. Again, VDS must be greater than VGS minus VT. Otherwise, it is 0. Otherwise, it is the oblique region. Okay. And VT, if it is depletion, then VT is indeed a pinch of voltage. And VT is a small negative quantity. Okay. It's a small negative quantity. On the other hand, if it is MOS enhancement type, then the same relationship holds, but VT is now a threshold voltage, threshold voltage, and has a slightly positive value. VT is greater than 0. For conduction, VGS now, mind this carefully, small VGS in an enhancement type, E-MOSFET, enhancement in MOS FET, VGS has to be more positive than VT. All right? If the two characteristics are drawn on the same graph, that is a plot of I sub D versus VGS, then for the depletion type, for the depletion type FET, that is D MOSFET or JFET, both of N channel, the characteristic would be like this. This is the transfer characteristic, that is a plot of the current I sub D versus VGS. If you plot this, obviously this will be a parabola, a square law characteristic, and the characteristic, where did it start? It would start from VP, agreed, or VT if it is DMOS. and this is a negative voltage, so it is somewhere here, Vp or Vt, and as the voltage exceeds Vp, that is when the voltage becomes less negative than Vp, the current rises and goes like this. It is a square law characteristic. Now, what is this current? IDSS. Why? Because here VGS is equal to 0. Okay. On the other hand, if it is an enhancement type MOSFET, then Vt is a small positive voltage, Vt, and the characteristic goes like this. It's a parabolic characteristic. All right. You notice also that in the biasing circuit, we are considering DC. All right. We can take the total voltage. There is no problem. VGS was equal to VGG minus R sigma ID, right? This is the condition, this is the expression giving the gate to source voltage as a function of VGG and I sub D, drain current. And you notice that this line, this straight line can be drawn on this characteristic, ID versus VGS. It is exactly the same as the load line, and it will start at VGG, and this current would be VGG by R sigma. Is that okay? So take these two points and draw the load line. This is the load line, transfer load line. These are known voltages and currents at the same pair of terminals. Okay? The voltage is between gate and source, and the current is in the drain, a third pair of third terminal, and therefore this is a transfer characteristic. This picture is worth 1000 words. It takes JFET, DMOSFET, EMOSFET, it shows the load line, it shows the operating point. Where is the operating point now? This is the operating point if it is EMOSFET, and this is the operating point if it is DMOSFET or JFET. Alright? And therefore, the Q point can be calculated graphically, all right, or it could also be done analytically. Let us look at how to do it analytically. Sir, yes.
What does the load line physically mean? What does it indicate?
Oh, it is the locus of variation of a current and a voltage. In this case, the load line is the locus of variation of drain current and the gate to source. That is, if the gate to source voltage varies, then your current variation must lie on this line. That's what it is. Okay, now if I want to do it analytically, we have seen how to do it graphically. If I want to do it analytically, let us for example consider a specific case, namely a JFET. If it is a JFET, N-channel JFET, then I sub D is equal to IDSS VGS minus Vp whole squared. No, I beg your pardon. It is written differently. Let me write it again. IDSS 1 minus VGS divided by Vp whole squared. I want to find the DC drain current. Okay? DC drain current, and I know then of course I sub D under the DC conditions, it is IDSS 1 minus VGS by Vp whole squared. In this you substitute the value of VGS. So it becomes IDSS 1 minus, what is VGS? VGS is VGG minus I sub D R sigma divided by Vp whole square. And you see that the right hand side contains the unknown, the left hand side of course is the unknown, and therefore it is what kind of equation?
Quadratic.
It's a simple quadratic equation which can be solved for I sub d. Quadratic equation has two roots by the fundamental theorem of equations. One of them would be acceptable, the other would not be acceptable. Now what would be the logic for rejecting one of the solutions?
ID
should be positive. Suppose both are positive. One of them will violate the condition that VDS is greater than VGS minus VP. So the one that satisfies this, the one that satisfies the relationship VDS greater than VGS minus VP is the solution to be taken. And there will be a large number of examples that will work out in the tutorial class, and also I will work out some in the Thursday class. Okay? So you can either do it graphically or analytically, and it turns out that analytically it's not very difficult, so why turn to a graph and draw a graph and be inaccurate and all that. Okay? Now with this out of the way, let's look at the AC equivalent circuit now. Because the AC mode line requires a knowledge of the AC equivalent circuit. Let's take the same circuit. As far as AC is concerned, we shall have Vs, Rs. The capacitor will become a short, and R1 and R2, they will combine into a single resistance Rg, which would be from the gate to ground. Is that correct? R2 will come in parallel with R1 because VDB is basically AC short. Then in the drain circuit, between the drain and the source, we shall have a current generator which is the incremental current generator. Okay? Incremental current generator, which we will find out. But that current generator shall feed an R sigma. You can't wish this away unless R sigma is short circuited. Alright. This capacitor we did not use earlier. Now we bring in this capacitor C3. R sigma is short circuited, and this current generator, incremental current generator, will feed RD and RL. C3 will be short. C2 will be short, so RD in parallel with RL. Now let's look at this circuit, then we will explain further. What we have is AC equivalent circuit. AC equivalent circuit, VS will come in series with RS, this is the source resistance. Then we have RG, which is the parallel combination of R1 and R2. This is your gate, and then you have a current generator. We will see what this current generator is. In the BJT case, it is a beta, it was beta small I subscript small b. Okay, let us see what this is here. We will see in a minute. But what this feeds is a parallel combination of, this is RL prime, where RL prime is RL parallel R sub d, the drain resistance. And this is the output voltage V0. Now, to determine what this current generator is, you recall that total drain current is given by IDSS 1 minus VGS divided by VP whole squared. Okay? You recall this. Now, what you have to do is to take the AC part of this. AC part of this, obviously, what we can do is take DID DVGS. Okay? What would be the dimension of this?
Conductance.
It's a conductance. It's a conductance, it should be denoted by G. It's a dynamic conductance. It should be denoted by small g. And because it relates a current in one terminal to the voltage across another two terminals, it is a transfer conductance or a transconductance. And if you differentiate this, you can easily see that this is given by minus 2 IDSS divided by VP multiplied by 1 minus VGS divided by VP. Note that I have shifted to capital VGS. Why? Because this is to be evaluated at the Q point. At the Q point. At the Q point, the voltage is VGS. Now, therefore, what I have is DID DVGS. I have found out a GM. This can be found for MOS FET. The expression will be slightly different. But you notice that DID is the increment in the total current. So DID can be replaced by small I subscript small d, and this is equal to GM times DVGS is the increment in the gate to source voltage. So small b, small v subscript small g, small s. Therefore, the current generator that you see here shall be GM times small v GS. This is the AC equivalent circuit. Okay. And you can make simple calculation of the gain, V0 by Vs. Very easy. Right? What is VGS? Where is the source now? This is the drain. Where is the source? Obviously, this terminal is the source. Why does the source come here? Because R sigma is grounded. R sigma is short circuited for AC.
So how is the source GM VGS AC?
How is the source GM? This is what I explained here. DID DVGS. DID is the increment in drain current, so it is I sub small d. And DVGS is the increment in the gate to source voltage, so this is VGS. Okay? So, you can calculate the gain very, very easily. You can see that small VGS, which is the voltage between these two terminals, is simply VS RG by RG plus RS. And V0 would be minus GM VGS multiplied by RL prime. And therefore, it is a very simple matter of calculation to find out what the gain is. You remember in the case of the BJT, we had an alternative circuit in which RE was made equal to 0. Alright? But there was a feedback from the collector to the base. Can we do the same with respect to FET? Let's draw this circuit. We have a VS, RS, capacitance, then we have the FET. For reasons to be explained in a minute, we show an enhancement type FET. E MOSFET. Enhancement type MOS FET. Okay? I'll explain this in a moment. Why I am not drawing any other. RS is, R sigma is 0. So it goes to ground. The drain terminal goes to plus VDD. Okay? And the biasing, if I take the same type of circuit, the biasing would be applied through a resistance. What shall we call this resistance? RG. R capital G. In the previous case, we had called it R capital B. Now, this is a perfectly good way of biasing. Your output comes from here, C2, and this is RL. This is V0. This is a perfectly good biasing provided it is an enhancement MOS FET. You cannot replace this FET by a JFET or a DMOSFET. And the reason is very simple. What is the reason? For enhancement MOS FET, VGS has to be positive. On the other hand, if it is a depletion mode operation, either a JFET or MOSFET, your VGS is equal to be negative. This circuit cannot give you VGS equal to negative. Unless there is a resistance here. if there is a resistance here, then Vg could be less than Vs. But here Vs is 0 identically. Therefore, this is one of the differences between FET and BJT, that this circuit is specific to E-MOSFET and is a popular circuit. Never make the mistake of having a biasing circuit for depletion mode with a circuit like this.
What is the advantage of this kind of a biasing?
Oh, advantage I already told you. It uses one resistance less. If you recall, instead of VBB, VBB was replaced by VCC, and therefore, wherever VBE occurs, VBE is much less compared to VCC than VBB. It's a more stable circuit than the previous one. Okay. And however, there is a problem of AC feedback. That is, AC signal current may flow through RG into the drain directly. For which the solution is that you break RG into two parts, RG1 and RG2, and bypass by means of a third capacitor. So you don't really save a resistor, okay? You don't really save a capacitor also. You have to use this. You have to two more components. You don't really save, but this is a good enough circuit. Due to some reason, if the source has to be grounded, then this is a solution, provided the FET is an enhancement mode MOS FET. As far as the effect of temperature is concerned, IDSS and GN, both of them decrease with rise of temperature. Can anyone explain why it is so? With rise of temperature, why IDSS and GN decrease? Because
resistance,
which resistance
of the channel?
It's not the resistance. Okay, that is a gross explanation. But what happens is, if temperature increase, the mobility decreases because they go on colliding with each other. They acquire more energy. They don't know how to dissipate the energy, so they fight each other. Okay, I hope this doesn't happen with human beings. Okay?
But at the same time, sir, the carriers also increase
as temperature increases. Carriers, it is an end channel, and therefore you should drive the device to its limit as much as it can afford. So that is marginal. But the energy of the increased thermal energy, it causes carriers to fight each other. They can't recombine with anybody. So they fight each other, they are of the same polarity, and the mobility is decreased. It is also true that VP, the pinch off voltage, increases with temperature increase. Pinch off voltage increases, but this effect is not very significant. It's insignificant increase. Okay. This takes us to have a look at a completely different type of biasing, which is to be used in integrated circuits, ICs. In integrated circuits, the biasing that we have discussed so far, either BJT or FET, cannot be used, because in integrated circuits there is a limit on the volume. There is a limit on the area of silicon that can be used. So, in integrated circuits, the main guiding principles are, in making an integrated circuit or in biasing, main guiding principles are that use transistors as many as possible to replace any other function. For example, a diode, you don't make a diode separately. Use a transistor. Connect what?
Base collector
short, that is the best diode in fact. Base collector short and the emitter is the other terminal. Okay? You can make diode can be made from a transistor in I think 6 different ways, of which the best is the one. Did you know this or you just guessed?
No, I
didn't know it. Okay. Alright. So whatever the function is, whether it's a diode or a resistance, even a resistance, use an FET between the drain and the source. Keep the gate open. Doesn't matter. Use this as a resistance. You understand what I mean? So use transistors. Why? Because resistors are more costly. Diodes are more costly than transistors. I'll tell you why. You see, in an integrated circuit, every step of fabrication, diffusion, oxidation, masking, every step has to be very precisely controlled. And when you make a transistor, let's say 2N222 or whatever the type is, if you want to change it to make a diode, it costs a huge lot of money because the whole process has to be stopped, reconfigured, and then carried out. So it costs money in terms of manpower, in terms of materials, in terms of the utility of the equipment. All right. So one standardizes one process. In a particular setup, let's say Motorola, they will only make transistors. They will not make anything else unless they are forced to. And these transistors, you can make millions in one chip, okay? In one of the wafers, you can make a million transistors. There's no problem, VLSI, with appropriate design. So use transistors as far as possible. As far as possible. If resistors are to be fabricated, then use the minimum number, okay, as few as possible. Use the minimum number of resistors of as small a value as possible, of as small a value as possible. Why is this so? The larger the value of the resistance, the more is the area of the wafer, area of the of silicon.
But at the same time, the current is also increased and the power dissipation.
Current is our choice. Current is our choice. We'll reduce the current. We'll reduce the current. You see, for amplification, the absolute level of current and voltage are not important. As long as you put the cue point in an appropriate operating point, and the dynamism, the dynamics of the whole situation is such that the dynamic range is not exceeded. That is, you don't go into cut off power dissipation or saturation or whatever it is, then you are perfectly safe. So current is in our control. And in integrated circuits, one of the guiding principles is use as little current as possible so that you don't have to provide for heat dissipation. Heat is a menace. It can cause havoc. So current is our choice. Use the minimum number of hours or as small a value as possible. As far as practicable, do not use capacitances. As far as practicable, do not use capacitances, because capacitances also are very costly. They use a large silicon area. Capacitance is directly proportional to the area. Not only that, if you want to make a large capacitance, the thickness, the separation between the two plates has to be made very small, which means the insulation strength of the capacitor will be very small. Alright? So, do not use capacitances unless you are forced to. If you have to use a capacitance, use a MOSFET. In a MOSFET, there is already a capacitance between the gate and the channel. So, use gate to source or gate to drain as a capacitance instead of a transistor, or use a reverse biased junction. A reverse biased junction acts as a capacitance. Alright? So this is what I said, use transistors as far as possible. If you have to make a capacitance of the pure kind, a parallel plate, well, then it is going to be costly. You try to avoid it as much as practical. If you are forced to, then of course there is no choice. All right. And the fourth guiding principle is inductors, forget about them. You can't make inductors in integrated circuits because there is a basic limitation, a fundamental limitation, the amount of flux that can be contained in a small volume of dimensions microns the amount of flux that can be contained is very, very small, unless the magnetic permeability or the magnetic field that is causing the flux is of astronomical magnitude. Naturally, you cannot have it in the laboratory, and you cannot have inductors unless you go to frequencies greater than 10 megahertz, let's say. If the frequency is very high, then a small piece of spiral, for example, will act as an inductor, good inductor. You require very small inductors, nanohenry order, and you can make it by depositing a conducting spiral, for example. Or there are many other geometries. You can make a loop like this, and this is one of the terminals, this is the other terminal. Okay? But this is at extreme high frequencies. Now therefore, if we have to be guided by this in integrated circuits, we cannot use that self bias BJT with four resistors or FET with so many resistors. We can't make them. So we have to think of something else, and this is done by what are known as current mirrors. Current mirrors. In a current mirror, not only, you see, if you have a BJT, what you have to do is to stabilize I sub C and VCE. This is the basic problem. Okay? And if I sub C is stabilized, then VCE is also stabilized, because VCE is VCC minus the drop in the collector resistance minus the drop in the emitter resistance. Okay. So basically our problem is to stabilize I sub C. And what is the stabilization? I sub C has to be stabilized against variations of beta, VBE and ICBO. Alright. One of the simple things, well, in a current mirror, the guiding the basic principle is that you make I sub C in a particular transistor independent of the parameters of that transistor. That is, you make a reflected, I am using a Shakespearean term, reflected glory. What you do is I sub C is controlled by another circuit. Okay? Another circuit, and therefore I sub C you make independent of the particular transistor in which it is flowing. This is why it is called a mirror. Mirror is what you see here is a reflection, as I said, reflected glory, is a reflection of what happens in another circuit. Alright? Let's see how this is performed. This is the significance of the term mirror. There is nothing else. Nothing else. It's a reflection. Purpose is to stabilize I sub C. If I sub C is independent of the parameters of this transistor, naturally it's stabilized.
But then it will depend
on
the stability of
okay,
the
okay, that we'll see. That we'll see. We'll make that transistor under very controlled conditions. So one transistor, one spot in the circuit will control stable collector currents in many other transistors. Okay, let's see how this is done. We recall this circuit for BJT biasing. We have an R sub C, then the emitter goes to ground, and there is a base resistance R sub B. We recall this biasing. In this biasing, where there is a feedback, that RB is split and all that is a different story, that only only affects the AC signal part, not the DC. Okay. Now in this circuit, I had told you that delta IC by IC1, that is the percentage change in the collector current, is given by delta beta by beta 1, let's recollect, RB divided by RB plus beta 2. Instead of RE, we shall have R sub C. That's the only change. RE is changed to R sub C and VBB is changed to VCC. Then due to VBE change, it is delta VBE divided by VCC minus VBE plus delta ICBO. Do not forget this negative sign. Delta ICBO RB plus, instead of RE it is RC, divided by VCC minus VBE. Alright. You also recall in the specific calculation that we had made that this, the beta variations accounted for the major change in I sub c. It was 9.2 in the particular example that we took. This was of the order of 4.6 or something, about half, and this was of the order of 0.66%. So the major variation occurs due to beta. And if I can make that 0, then obviously I would have improved matters. And making it 0 simply means make Rb equal to 0. So if I use this circuit, R sub c, let us see what happens. This goes to ground, and instead of a resistance, we simply use this. Okay? Then what is VCE? Well, this goes to 0, all right. And therefore, the I sub c is stabilized to a degree greater than when Rb was there, all right. But what happens to VCE now for this transistor? Isn't it the same as VBE? VCE is the same as VBE. Is it a diode basically?
Yes, sir.
It's basically a diode. A transistor is being operated as a diode. Now, VBE in the active region, as we know, is about 0.7 volt. Is the transistor then in the active region? Well, it's greater than 0.2. So it is very close to saturation, but in the active region. We will not require this transistor to amplify. What we will do is we will use this current as the reference current. We will use this current as the reference current. So we shall call this we shall change the nomenclature a little bit. We shall call this as the reference current, and we shall call this resistance as R1. Then you see I ref is simply VCC minus VBE divided by R1, correct? I ref is VCC minus VBE divided by R1. Agree? Now, this is our reference current. How can this current change? Why should this current change? The current can change if there is a change in VBE, obviously. The current can also change if there is a change in ICBO. But as you know, the changes in VBE and ICBO are much less as compared to the change in beta. And therefore, if this transistor goes bad and you replace it by another transistor, nothing happens because it has been made independent of beta. This is the basic point. All right. Now, this transistor as a reference is used to control the current, collector current of another transistor. And the connections are made like this. This is plus VCC. There is a resistance R1. Then you have this connection, call this transistor as Q1, the emitter goes here, this base is then connected to another transistor, the current of which has to be controlled or stabilized, the operating point of which has to be stabilized, let's call this I sub C2, let's call it as output current, and let's call this voltage as V0. Okay, this voltage is V0, I'm sorry. That is the VCE of Q2. This may be connected to a load. We are not showing that part of the circuit. We are showing only the DC collector current. Now, this goes to the same point. The emitters are tied together. The bases are tied together. Okay, and this goes to, it may go to ground, but in integrated circuits, usually integrated circuits are operated with a plus minus supply, which helps in stabilizing operating point and in getting many other kinds of functions than is possible with only one supply. So it goes to minus VEE. This goes to a negative supply. Usual supplies are, let's say, plus minus 12. VCC may be plus 12, then VE is minus 12. The ground is the middle point of this supply, okay? Right. Now, this is a typical current mirror arrangement. Why is it called a current mirror? Because, as we shall show, I0 is approximately equal to IR or I reference. Reference, I don't want to write REF every time, I will simply say IR, okay? Now, you know that the collector current of a transistor, collector current of a transistor is approximately equal to the emitter current. Actually, it is alpha times IE plus ICBO, okay, alpha times IE plus ICBO. ICBO can be ignored, and therefore it is alpha times IE, and alpha is approximately 1, and therefore the collector current is approximately equal to the emitter current, and the emitter current is a diode current, and therefore it is of the form IS, particularly when it is forward biased, it is IS exponential Q VDE, let us use capital, divided by KT. Agreed? Now, therefore, the collector current of a transistor depends basically on the base to emitter voltage. And since the two base to emitter voltages of Q1 and Q2 are identical, they are identical, the collector currents IC2 and IC1 should be identical. All right. So, the first thing that you notice is that the output current that we want, I0, is equal to I(C1). All right. How is IC1 related to IR? As you see, IR equal to IC1, okay, IC1, then there is a base current here, there is a base current here. The two base currents shall be identical because VBE is the same, all right. And these two base currents must come from here. Therefore, this is equal to twice IB1 plus IB2 or twice IB, which is IC divided by beta. So, twice IC1 divided by beta. Therefore, my relationship becomes IC1 1 plus 2 by beta, and if beta is much greater than 2, which is usually the picture, if beta is 100, it is 1 by 50, 0.02, 2% change, then IR is approximately equal to IC1.
So, what is IC1?
IC1 is the collector current of the transistor Q1, I have indicated this. This is IC1, collector current of Q1, which means that the output current I0 is approximately equal to I1. The output current is approximately equal to I1.
How did you get the first equation?
Which for this one? Oh, okay. I'll explain. This first is IR is IC1, that is the current through the collector, plus this current. By KCL, this current must be equal to the base current of Q1 plus the base current of Q2. And these two currents must be identical, so twice IB, and IB is IC over beta. Is the point clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And therefore, I0 is equal to IR. And what is IR now? What is the reference current here? It is VCC minus VEE, so it will be VCC plus VEE minus VBE divided by R1, okay. So, this is VCC plus VEE minus VBE divided by R1. Now, VBE strictly should be replaced by KT by Q log of Y, because this is a collector current and it is IS e to the power Q VBE by KT. So, it should be replaced by ln I(0) divided by IS. Isn't that right?
So, what should be replaced?
VBE. because I0 equal to Is e to the power q VBE by kT. Therefore, VBE should be replaced by this quantity. If I do that, then what kind of equation do I get? I get a transcendental equation. And I don't want to solve the transcendental equation. So what is the way out? Way out is engineering, common sense. Common sense, it is said, is the strongest tool of an engineer. And here, you see, VBE would be a small quantity compared to VCC plus VEE. In integrated circuits, invariably there is a positive supply and a negative supply. Therefore, this would be of the order of, let's say, 24. And VBE, you know, in the we want the transistors to be in the active region. So active region VBE is approximately 0.7. Therefore, this is a negligible quantity, and instead of solving a transcendental equation, I replace this by 0.7. And I get a fairly good working relationship, design relationship for a current mirror. Therefore, the resistance R1 that I need is VCC plus VEE minus 0.7 divided by whatever current I need. Okay, IC2, which is approximately equal to I reference. All right, which is approximately equal to I reference. For example, if I want, let's say, 500 microampere, and VCC and VEE both are 15 volt, let's say, plus minus 15. Then R1 comes out as 30 minus 0.7, which is 29.3 divided by 500 microampere, and this comes out as 58.6K. Alas, this is a large value.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, in the expression for IR, we are ignoring 2 by beta, 1 plus 2 by beta.
Yes, we are.
But if you are supplying many different circuits, like you said you are supplying 10 or more, then you cannot ignore in that case.
Wonderful. Then we will have to have super betas. If I want to supply 10 of these circuits, then obviously if I want to supply 10 transistors from the reference current, if I want to supply the base current of 10 transistors from the reference current, then obviously these two shall be replaced by
11.
10 or 11?
11.
11. Why 11? So because the reference transistor also supplies a base current. Okay, so it would be 11. Therefore, beta must be much larger compared to 11. And as I said, if I use a Darlington, that's another thing that is used in ICs. Invariably, instead of one transistor, you use two transistors. Let me show you this. What we do actually is this. The collectors are brought together, and this is the emitter, this is the base, this is the collector. There's a composite connection. So if I supply an I sub B here, signal current, this current is approximately beta IB, and this current would be approximately beta squared IB. So if I had a beta of 50, I can get a beta of 2500 without any problem. Your question is quite valid. If my current mirror has to supply a large number of transistors, then the current mirror must be made of a Darlington.